Well, hello, happy Thursday, everyone. We are here with Atlanta Film Festival. My name is Karen Ceesay, your moderator for the evening. We've been doing these live stream interviews since June. I can't even remember, this whole year is like a blur, right? But we're on the other side now, guys. We're on the other side of it, so we're all coming along. Oh, I always forget to mute, so if you just heard that, that's my muting capability. So we have a couple of things. We're even closer to the film festival, which is now in September. And keep an eye on the website for Atlanta Film Festival to know whatever updates you need to know about, to make sure that you are all in the know. Did I say no? I said no 12,000 times. We took a week off last week, so maybe I'm a little bit flabbergasted. But we've got a great director with us today. We've got Christian Nolan Jones. And we will talk to him in a minute, but just wanted to let you know what's going on. We are in the middle of a screenwriting class, so if you didn't sign up for it, it's too late because it's going on. But just to let you know, diverse voices and stories, that's a class that's going on, and it's just an example of all the different types of classes that Atlanta Film Society offers. The PA Academy starts next week, but that is most likely already booked up, but it, you know, so many people come and talk to me and they'll be like, how do I get in the film industry? I highly suggest that the next availability, I'm not sure, maybe Krupa knows and maybe she could tell me, but if not, this is the summer PA Academy. It's usually seasonal. So keep an eye out on that. If you're someone that wants to know about how to get into the industry, Linda Burns will teach you everything you need to know. And the PA Academy, I just cannot stress enough about what a great level of instruction you'll get and the type of networking pool you will establish. So keep an eye for that. We've got a really awesome class coming up with a friend of mine, Jan Mullins. And she is doing Directing from the Heart. It begins August the 18th. She has two scholarships available for Black filmmakers, and Kathy Barotti's screenwriting series will return in October. So everything is available on the website. Again, as I said, we're 42 days away from the festival. So all of this information I just talked about, everything's on the website. Go to AtlantaFilmSociety.org or AtlantaFilmFestival.com. So now I mentioned that we have a wonderful filmmaker with us this evening, Christian Nolan Jones. He is the creator of the film Brown with Blue. And before we talk to him, we're going to take a minute and check out his trailer. All right, so let's go to that trailer.
Why we keep doing this shit?
Oh, I had my mic muted, y'all. Oh, I was steady talking, and I had my mic muted. You know, modern technology. So we're going to do that again. Christian Nolan Jones is our filmmaker that's with us this evening. And wanted to welcome you again. It's the you've created the film. It's a short called Brown with Blue. Before we start talking about that, we definitely want to find out a little bit more about you. What's your background? Where have you been holding up in 2020? And, you know, any other fun tidbits you want to tell us about?
Well, I'm from Atlanta. I'm from the East Side. Down here. I was living there for 8 years. But COVID gave me a reason to come back. So, you know, and I've been enjoying my time home with family. So, yeah.
So, okay, but New York now, they getting a little hardcore for real now. I heard New York real now. I heard New York City is going to be shutting down the...
Not shutting down.
Well, not shutting down, but they're
putting the checkpoints in
everywhere.
Coming into New York.
I dodged that. I was down here in February working on a couple gigs.
And
then
the pandemic kind of hit.
And I had to decide whether or not I wanted to keep paying rent up there.
I went up for a week and just packed up my apartment, decided to stay here for the rest of the year.
Much of the New York experience.
Basically, my mom is supportive of your career up to this point, and just like, come on home, baby. She's been my biggest fan, and took her a while to get her, you know, on the artistic front, and the beginning, but the more success she saw me have, the stronger her support has become. So, she's happy to have me home because I was an empty nester at that point.
I think she was going to reload me. So
yeah, we're all ready for you guys. Yeah, we're all ready for you guys to get out of the house. And then once you're gone, it's like,
where's your baby?
Well, so how was your childhood then? Were you making films? Were you doing things that might have given a clue to what you were going to end up doing as a grown up?
Nah, not at all, actually. I thought I was going to be like a pediatrician. Like, that was my goal. And then I got to college and I found out I had to keep doing math. And I was like, oh, this is not for me. But luckily, I discovered filmmaking like my senior year of high school. And I had made my first attempt at a short by that point. And I decided to just spend all the money I had from a scholarship on a camera. And that just kind of started my journey.
So that's the seed. Well, the investment, the first investment and everything.
Yeah.
Well, what do you think it was that let you know that this is the right decision? This is what I need to do.
It was something that came really easy to me as far as like understanding how the camera worked and I guess shaping stories. So, and it was really fun. So maybe I thought that it was easy, but it didn't matter that I didn't know what I was doing because, you know, I was just enjoying myself at the time. And while I was on campus, I just threw myself into every project I could. So I was shooting for like people's political campaigns when they were running for office on campus. And I would do like little promos for people. And eventually that gave me kind of the confidence that I needed to try to tell my first story. So, yeah.
So, okay. So you ATLian.
Yeah.
Where'd you go to high school?
I went to Southwest DeKalb and I went to North, well, it's not North Druid Hills, Druid Hills. But yeah, I went to Southwest DeKalb and Druid Hills.
Have you made it back there at all since you've been in college? Have you come back and been like, I'm a New Yorker. Have you done that back to high school?
My tenure for both high schools was supposed to be this year, and COVID ruined that too. But I mean, I'm still in touch with a bunch of people that I went to high school with. Like, they're still my closest friends to this day, which is real rare. But yeah.
So how have they been like with regards to once you became a filmmaker? How was the reception from people back home, your friend pool?
Man, the support from back home is it's nonstop. People really love to see what I'm doing. They love to help out. Everybody wants to be an extra, or you know, get that that starring role. But I mean, yeah, my friends here helped me out so much. Like even with Brown with Blue, one of my friends gave me his apartment for 2 days, and you know, he stayed up until 4 a.m. just watching us shoot, and didn't have one complaint. You know, even though we were way over the 12-hour mark. But yeah, it's nonstop. Whenever people can help, they will. So you know, I love Atlanta for that.
And that's a big thing though, right? Is having support around you. A lot of times I feel like that's one of the most important things about being an artist, is having the proper energy and the proper emotional support, not just physical support. If you were to rank it, if you had a friend that was there to support you, or a friend that was just like, I can write you a check, right? Or someone that had some, what would you take, the emotional support or the check? I know what you're gonna say.
I'm going to play it neutral and say that all love is appreciated.
All support matters.
All support matters for sure. But you know, cause you never know, like, you know, as an artist, I think you go through like waves of confidence in yourself, you know? So, you know, that emotional support might come right on time, you know, when I really need it, when I'm really hesitant about, that one concept or that one scene, and you know, when somebody puts the battery in your back, you're like, okay, you know, I can keep going. And you know, that's really carried me over the years, especially living in New York. It was, you know, there are good times and there are definitely some bad times. So yeah.
So when did you leave Atlanta to go to school?
I left in 2010, and I started out at Howard, and I was there for 2 years in DC, and it was just a wonderful experience. You know, once again, just friends that I met there, I'm still really close with to this day. And I'm pretty sure I got a few Howard people watching right now. So shout out to H. You know
what I'm saying? Shout out to my writing partner, Andre, and my sister, Kelly. But she'll never be watching nothing, so I don't know if she's watching. No, my baby sister. Also Howard alum. The HBCU experience is so important. And I know you're saying you went there for 2 years, and it doesn't matter. It's like, I know people that went for like a semester, and they're like, oh my God, I loved it. So how do you think the HBCU experience, however short, shaped what type of projects you wanted to do, shaped how you viewed yourself in making the move to NYU?
Well, see, like, I think that it's just important to be surrounded with like like-minded people, people who you can really bounce it made it easier for me when I got to NYU, when I was the only Black person in, you know, all of my film classes, basically, you know, and I definitely couldn't depend on, you know, that sounding board from my other students. So like, for instance, one of my first documentaries was about blackface. And I remember showing that in the doc class at NYU, and everybody's like, mouths were just on the floor, and they're like, apologizing to me.
And I was like, I don't know why you're apologizing.
You know, this is just history. Right. You know, just be hip to it. You know, without Howard, I wouldn't have had the confidence to tell a story like that in a room full of white faces. So yeah.
Right. So okay. So you left in 2010, which is really kind of right before. I mean, the film industry here has been growing for over 40 years, but, you know, it was still kind of not what it is now. 2013, like 12, 13 is probably when Georgia really started pushing and gaining a lot more momentum. So leaving in 2010 and then coming back in 2020, living here now and as a filmmaker, having done work, how do you compare the two, and what type of opportunities do you see for yourself now, even in the middle of a pandemic?
I mean, it's surreal just to see how much it's caught on here, and like not even on, you know, the major scale, but on the indie level, I'm just seeing so many people creating, so many people who own their own, you know, production houses, and there's just like a vast network. So whenever I'm working on projects, you know, it's a lot easier to navigate now than like when I was in college. Like, it was a lot harder to shoot in Atlanta. But the most surreal thing that's happened for me was coming back here to shadow on a TV show, and like the studio being based, you know, on Boulder Crest, which is like 10 minutes from where I went to high school and like 15 minutes from where I live. So, and I'm telling them that in my interview, and they're like, oh, okay, whatever. But I'm like, you know, you guys don't even understand. This is crazy.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's wonderful, you know, and it definitely lets me know that, you know, I could possibly stay here and carve out, you know, a career rather than going to LA or going back to New York.
You think folks in New York are sleeping on Atlanta?
But, you know, people always sleeping on Atlanta, for sure.
Yeah.
People always sleeping on Atlanta. But, you know, it's the best city in the world for a reason.
See, I should have worn my Atlanta Influences Everything shirt.
Everything, come on. Come on, everything.
So what do you think are certain stories then? Because you've been able to be in a couple different types of situations since you've been a filmmaker. I look forward to getting into Brown with Blue. But for right now, I just want to see what type of stories do you think you want to tell, and how has Atlanta shaped your storytelling?
I feel like Atlanta culturally is like very specific. So I try to carry that like specificity to the stories that I tell. Like, for instance, like Print Shop was about like a guy who made Rest in Peace t-shirts, and like that's a very like niche like Black experience, but it's something that is very broad also, like, so people like from hoods all over America, or, you know, just Black people from all over America, you know, from family reunions to, you know, people passing away, they can understand t-shirt culture. And I kind of tried to take a step away from that with Brown with Blue a little bit, but my next project is similar in the respect of being specific, because it's literally just about me growing up on the East Side and in the early 2000s. So, you know, that's a very, like, if you're from Atlanta, or if you're in my age group, you'll understand like why that's a very like specific time, because there were just a lot of things going on. So I try to carry like very specific niche topics to, I guess, like a broader audience.
And that's a good place to go, because that is what we have to do. We have to have a specific voice, but it still has to connect with a broader audience. So, you know, right now there's so much outreach, specific outreach to the Black community, to the communities of color. How do you find ways to be specific and broad simultaneously?
I mean, I really just look at like my own experiences, or I try to tap into like things that I really enjoy about my culture, or I'm trying to give a specific answer. So I'm writing a short right now, and it's about this boy getting his first chain, a fake chain from the flea market. So everybody hasn't, you know, probably gone to a flea market to buy a fake chain to impress a girl, right? But they have done something in the attempt of, you know, impressing someone, or, you know, trying to keep up with the Joneses. So it's just about taking something really small that just relates to me personally and might relate to, you know, people personally around me, and trying to figure out an avenue to express it, you know, to people further than that.
Now, again, you've kind of left and come back, and Atlanta has experienced, and I'm not saying you haven't been home for Thanksgiving or anything in this time, but, you know, it's, okay, I've got alarms. Let's see if that's going back. All right. Atlanta has just changed so drastically. Mm-hmm. With just the number of people that are here, and gentrification is a big, big thing, a big, big part of that. How do you think that changes what the Atlanta thing is? You know?
It's tough because, you know, this is happening everywhere. So I try not to, like, make it an Atlanta thing. But, you know, when it's your city, it's really difficult to witness, like, people not really, I guess, giving the city of the past, like, the same respect, or, you know, the residents that have been here for years, and, you know, complaining about things like people, like, even before, like, the whole firework epidemic that happened, like, earlier in the summer, you know, people moving into the neighborhoods around me were complaining about people, you know, popping fireworks, you know, but even though it's, like, on the weekend, or, like, you know, everybody knows that Edgewood Ave is going to go up on the weekend, and, you know, people are still calling the police on people and things like that. But, you know, these things have been happening before people moved here. So it's really crazy to see just this power struggle between the newcomers and the residents that have been here. So, and then at the same time, you know, because a lot of my memories of Atlanta are, like, tied into my childhood, to see, like, buildings getting taken down, or, like,
renovated. Shop going up. Organic dog biscuits.
Yeah, it's like, oh, man, this is whack. What is this, man? You know, but it's life. You know, I kind of, that's what's so cool about being an artist, though, because, you know, I can take my memories and, you know, really implant them into my work, right, if I so choose, you know. So that's the cool thing about it.
So, okay, so you've come home and it's a pandemic going on. Mm-hmm. So you can't really go out and hang out and mingle, or do eat, drink, and be indie with ATLFF. you know, so how do you see using, I mean, the rest of this year is a wrap, really. I mean, you know, it's 2020 is a wrap. You know, we could all do stuff and bide our time till Christmas, but this is really what we're going to be living. So how do you see you taking part? Like, what do you see your next couple of months looking like here? Is it writing? Is it, you know, trying to connect with people online? Like, how do you see these next couple of months playing out for you?
It's definitely going to be a lot of writing. A lot of writing ahead of me, a lot of editing. That's kind of what I've been spending my time doing. Playing a lot of 2K as well. You know, yeah. Me and my friends are usually online and, you know, yelling at some random people on the other side of the earth. But, you know, that's kind of been my main goal, to just prepare for the next year and just stay ready for, like, when things, you know, begin to open back up, so I don't miss out on any opportunities, especially since, you know, people are wanting to just show a lot of love to Black creators right now. So, you know, I don't want to miss out on that. But it really, I struggle with the fact that I had so much momentum going into this year, and it's just everything just cut short. But, you know, I also got a much needed break from just constantly just working on the next project and the next project and the next project. It really wears down on you.
Yeah, it's been a rough year, but by the same token, some people have been able to flip it a little bit. Yeah. And, you know, other people are doing, you know, it's going to be scary in a minute, depending on what happens, you know, with the unemployment benefits and the additional stipend. So we're getting ready to see some big changes happening to our country. Of course, we've seen all these big changes, but now it's really going to hit. It's just, I mean, that's just a note. Look, that's just an observation that I'm a little nervous for.
You're going to be all right. You're going to be all right.
Yeah. Hey, everybody be fine. So your film, Brown with Blue. Mm-hmm. Take us on that journey of how you conceptualized it, how you went toward getting it made, you know, your journey before you even started shooting day one.
Man, this one was so different than my first film out of school, because that one was funded, luckily, and that made things so much easier.
Well, pause. How'd you go about getting your funded? Because you know people that are watching want to know.
So I had a friend who was, you know, very financially savvy. His name is Sean Valentine. And he actually, I was staying with him when he convinced me to screen my film at like an art show that he wanted me to help him put together. And he was like, you should screen your film too. So I screened my film and everybody loves it. And I was so nervous that entire time, but you know, I guess he got really excited about, you know, the fact that the film was actually good, like, cause I hadn't shown anybody at that point. And he said, you know, let's make a film about somebody who makes Rest in Peace t-shirts. And like, literally my brain just went 10 million places. You know, I had so many ideas. And he, you know, was like, you know, if you can come up with a good script, you know, I think that I, alongside, you know, other people that I work with, because he worked in the financial investment sector, like he said.
Boy, those friends help, don't they? Boy, those friends help.
But he said, you know, I might be able to piece together some funding for it. And we decided that we wanted to shoot in Philly because he's from Pottstown. And
what's up, Philly?
I had been traveling back and forth from Philly, and like I just love like cities that have like a rich like Black history, like so even in New York, like I try to stay like in the blacker, the browner neighborhoods, you know, Harlem, you know, Bed-Stuy. I lived in Fort Greene. I didn't get the Black Fort Greene, but you know, it was cool that I was living in Fort Greene because of just the history behind it. But fast forward. He says, you know, let's shoot in Philly. And my producer at the time was like, man, I don't know nothing about Philly, man. So in order for him to write this film, I feel like we all need to just move to Philly. So I moved out of my apartment in Brooklyn and I moved to Philly for 3 months, and we spent the time just writing and really going through pre-production. And like, that was the purest experience I've ever had just as a filmmaker, just because that was the only time that I've just specifically been able to just focus on just the art, and I had money to make the film too, so it was like, that was the best experience ever.
That's better. You have money and time and access. That's the goal, right?
Exactly.
So now we finished Print Shop. We did all that. Now we're working on the next project. How did that? Because I really want to talk about how you conceptualized this, because it kind of played like a poem to me, kind of. Where like, hey. There was,
Hey, I like that.
Yeah, it played like a poem to where, you know, it was like symbolic, but the, you know, I love the way it looked too. I absolutely loved the way it looked. It looked great. You know, so just tell me
about a couple, you know, on drugs. And like, as I started writing it, I realized that I couldn't really relate to like that sort of drug use, because, you know, it's older, and then, you know, I don't know any people who do heroin. So I decided to make the characters younger, and I decided to make the drug of choice pills. So I just sat with this idea. Like, I usually sit with ideas for like a really long time, and just talk to people about them, you know, think about them constantly, like before I even write anything down. And for a screening for Print Shop, I met a young man. His name was Dominic. And like, I had known him prior to, you know, just from being from Atlanta. And, you know, I told him about the idea. Like, you know, later that week, we got on the phone just talking about projects that we were working on and stuff. And he was like, man, you really need to write that. And I was like, for real, you think people would be interested in that story? And he was like, yeah, man, like, just write it. He was like, I'll help you. So literally, you know, that's how my co-writer came into the mix. And if it wasn't for him, like, I might have still been conceptualizing the story right now. But it, yeah.
Deadlines.
I have no use for deadlines at all. They just don't work for me. But it started as something else, and you know, I'm really happy with like how it turned out. This is my first film where I'm like completely satisfied, you know, from top to bottom with, you know, how it turned out.
Now, you've had some experience shooting videos, like music videos and everything too, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I definitely saw that influence in it. The one scene when they went to the club and just the lighting, I loved it, you know? So that really visually, it was just a visual delight for me. Zoe, I was telling you, she wasn't in my scene, but I met her when she was a teenager on Read Between the Lines with Tracy Ellis Ross and Malcolm Jamal Warner. And so it was nice to see her grown up and playing a grown up role and, you know, so I enjoyed that as well. Both of your leads that had great chemistry. How was the audition process?
So I did something different for this one. I didn't audition. Well, I did ask people for self-tapes, but we were trying to like work with like actors with some credits. So I guess, you know, I'll just tell everybody what I did, but my manager was working at a talent agency at the time. So basically we used his login, the IMDb Pro, to find people's contacts. And, you know, he gave us like the emails that we needed to send to sound professional.
I don't know if you should be telling that. No, right? Let me tell it.
No. Oh man, my agent is probably looking at this right now. That's bad. But anyway.
Everybody can get on IMDb Pro though.
Talking basically for 15 minutes, just talking about where we're from, like how we grew up. And honestly, like I don't need to even see like any sort of like self-tape or anything. Like me and him vibe, I know that we're on the same page and it's gonna work. And you know, the same thing happened with Zoe with our phone call. Like it just, and they actually knew each other prior to us getting on set. So like they were already friends, and you know, they helped me out a lot for sure. It was just a wonderful experience, you know, working with the two of them, to be honest.
So something you said did kind of strike me when you said he helped you put your emails together so they sounded professional and you looked like a professional, and they based off the deck. How, because you're still, you know, fairly young, but you've gone through a lot, like I guess in these last 10 years, professionalism. How do you see how you've learned? Because these are things that they don't teach you in college about, you know, how to be a professional and how to look professional. What's been your journey with that?
It's a constant learning experience. I'm sorry. This past year, I've kind of been getting into the mode of like having generals and, you know, meeting with people. And I'm from the South, so I'm just naturally I have those extra manners. Like I want to be extra nice. So, you know, that works in my favor. But honestly, what I've learned is if you're being yourself, and you know, you're not saying anything offensive to anybody or anything like that. Like usually, you know, in a speaking setting, you're fine. But as far as like writing emails, it's definitely been some things I've had to learn, like not overly emailing people, always following up. You know, when you say that you're going to, when you say that you're going to meet a deadline, you know, you definitely got to do that because other people, rely on you in that situation. So like when I have commercial projects or, you know, projects like music videos, I know that I'm only like one piece of the cog. So, you know, as big as my ego is as a director, you know, they're not going to get this until it's ready. You know, it's really, you kind of have to bring yourself back a couple notches.
Yeah. So. I know one of the things that works against youth, I remember some, like when I was straight out of college and I met somebody and sent something, I literally wrote something on like a piece of lined paper and sent it. Right? Like, but what I found a lot of times with younger people, because of social media, like they're too familiar and too casual with the conversation. And I think that's one of the things that's really important is to up the level of professionalism. Use your $5 and $10 words, you know, sparingly, but good sentence structure, you know, all those types of things. And honey, manners maketh man. Manners are so important. And I come from a, you know, Philly, you were in Philly, you know, we're not like the friendliest people necessarily, even though we're the city of brotherly love. You know, we look hardcore. I had to, you know, soften up those edges when I came down south because I was making a lot of people angry. And I'm like, what? You know, what? I just said this. You know, so that's really important to be able to communicate effectively both in person, on the phone, and on email, which it's much more professional. What are some of the ways that you think other people can get into the film industry?
So I know a lot of people like to PA or like work in specific crew positions, but if somebody wants to be a writer or a director or a cinematographer, like just go for it. You know, just try to gather up whatever resources you can and just create. Like even if it's not up to like your level of taste, because it's still something for your portfolio, for your experiences. And like honestly, I did a lot of bad work in my eyes. Like I did a lot of bad work before I did anything that I felt was like really good that I could stand on. So that's really like my biggest advice to anybody is just to figure out a way to create and do it. And I know that that's like easy for me to say because sometimes resources can be limited, but you never, like I tell people all the time, if you don't ask, you never know, you know, what somebody is willing to do for you. A lot of times I've just mentioned something to someone and they've been like, oh yeah, I can help you with that. Oh yeah, I have a camera for you that you can use. You know, last year was my first year owning a camera since college. Mm-hmm. So, and you know, that hasn't really stopped me as a director. And also shadowing people, figuring out like how to like ask questions about people's processes without being, you know, too invasive, or, you know, really studying someone's work that you really like, starting with movies that you like and then figuring out what that key position is and like following whoever that is on other projects. That's definitely, it's easy to do as a director because that name is there, but you know, if you want to be an art director, or if you want to be a gaffer, or if you want to be a cinematographer, like got to do a little bit more digging and just follow, you know, that person's work and watch their interviews, things like that. Like that's stuff that I still do now for certain people.
So what was your crew situation like? Cause so Print Shop, you shot that down here? No, you shot Brown and Blue here.
Yeah, Brown and Blue. Yeah, I shot that.
And here. Print Shop was in Philly.
Yeah.
So what was your crew situation? How did you crew up? People from New York?
I worked with people from New York and Atlanta. Mm-hmm. Most of my above the line positions were from New York. Like we all drove down together. Mm-hmm. And my cinematographer came from Mexico. That was really interesting. I went to the Cannes Film Festival in 2012, and I met this guy in line waiting to watch a film. And he was like, yeah, I'm a cinematographer. And we just kept in touch, and we tried to figure out, like, the right project to work on together. And, like, Daniel Anguiano is his name, by the way. Shout out my boy Daniel. But
beautiful work, Daniel. Beautiful.
He's amazing. He's amazing. He's like a film purist. So, but, and like, as far as a lot of the extras, those are like people that I grew up with, people who I'm friends with in the city. You know, now I got a lot of people who, a lot of my friends make music. So a lot of their music is in the film too. A lot of the people that you see in the film, their music is in the film as well. So I tried to like make it a real, I guess like family affair. One of the houses that we shot at is a house that I used to frequent a lot, like as a kid, like my family would have barbecues there. It's on the south side. It's right off of Cascade.
So that's a big thing, because right now we're at this place where we can't be in person. I'll have to say last year's Atlanta Film Festival, I really, really, I think I did more with the festival than normal. And I, you know, had a great time and was really, you know, met a lot of people there and really looking forward to seeing everyone again. And then the pandemic happens and, you know, we have to kind of forward it. Comic-Con, I was able to do Comic-Con like 2 years ago and met people. And it's like, it's the building of relationships. And that's another thing that's not really taught, is the necessity to be able to build relationships and pocket them. You know what I mean? Like everything isn't right now, right now. It might be something 5 years from now, you know? So how do you think people need to do that? And how are you doing it now that we don't really have physical access, but there seems to be a little bit more online access? Have you found that to people?
Definitely. I mean, it's like relationship building, I've learned, is just about genuinely caring about, you know, what somebody else has going on. So just checking in with people and trying to, you know, figure out if that project is something that, you know, the two of you can work on. If not, you know, just keep supporting from afar. I definitely have been trying to FaceTime people and just see how they're doing. I'm really bad at that at the same time. So I appreciate it when somebody reaches out to me when they've crossed my mind, because I'm like, oh, thank you. You know, I was going to forget for another 2 weeks. But, you know, that's definitely a key component of just building relationships, just nurturing them and, you know, treating them, you know, with care. I had to learn that the hard way in New York, because, you know, everybody was like...
the hard way. Okay, so what's the hard way? And you were in New York, Southern boy up in New York. What was the hard way?
I just thought that, you know, right away, people would work and, you know, oh, we're in New York, you got projects, I shoot, like, we're going to be working together, you know, and you're going to be waiting a long time sometimes before things go through, or, you know, they might not pan out, and it's not really anybody's fault, other than it just didn't work out that time. So just, you know, try to develop a tough skin when it comes to projects or opportunities, because you're going to hear a lot of no's, you know, as an artist. And it's okay. It doesn't really mean anything, other than you were told no that one time. You're going to hear a lot of yeses as well.
Well, you know what they say, it takes 10 no's to get to a yes. So every time I get to a no, I'm like, I'm that much closer to my yes.
Hey, I like that. I never heard that before. I like that.
That's the rule of sales. It takes 10 no's to get to a yes. That's okay. Just, you know, so you want to just go on and get those no's.
Definitely.
Knock out those no's.
Wait.
Yes.
Let's,
you know? Anyone who's watching, you can ask questions at any time. Our girl Krupa is in the background, making sure that we get your questions. And I'll find a way to slip it into the convo. But it really is, it's just so important about collaboration, about keeping in touch with people, networking, because it is a long-term business. You know, when you first come out, there's this, you know, when you're young and you have that energy and that optimism, you just add it. And then, you know, the business is like, and then when you pick yourself back up again, you know, you're like, okay, let me reassess. So we're nearing the end of our conversation. Did I tell you it was going to fly by?
You're amazing. You made me feel so comfortable this time.
Stop. Tell me more, please. But so, you know, let's just end on a little bit more of what you want to do, what are some of the things you want to do, and how you want to, you know, you've come home and how you want to use your voice here, then now you back in the act.
Yeah, so I'm definitely trying to tell my next film that I'm writing is called Kinfolk, and it's like an autobiography about growing up on the east side of Atlanta, and I definitely just wanted to be an authentic piece so that, you know, we can really get a real Atlanta story. Like, we got ATL, but that wasn't, you know, made by somebody from that wasn't made by somebody from Atlanta. So I definitely, you know, want to be the one to bring that to the city.
I tell you this much, as long as I've been here, I've been here since college, and the first thing that I've ever seen that really resonated to me as Atlanta was Atlanta. You know what I mean? When that came out, I'm like, oh, I know those brothers. Like, I know Paperboy, you know, I know that guy.
Yeah, definitely. That show is so funny.
But what is your favorite part of the film creation process?
My two favorite parts, I have to say two because it's like equal for me, but the ideation phase and then that first rehearsal, like when you first give, you know, a scene legs and you're seeing the actors take what you've written on the page to a new level. You know, because there's like an instant growth. And you see what works, you see what doesn't work. And it's just exciting. I don't know how to explain it, but that's definitely, you know, my favorite part besides the ideation phase.
Okay. And when will we be able to watch Brown with Blue? I'm not sure where it's in with ATL, you know, with the film festival, but where else is it showing or how else is it showing?
We will, you know, once we get to the festival circuit, you know, hopefully this fall we'll be streaming it online somewhere. I don't want to say anything just yet, but I do have plans to show it to the world so that I can let it go and move on to the next project.
Yes. Well, what a beautiful project it was. The film is Brown with Blue. Our wonderful filmmaker is Christian Nolan Jones. Thank you so much for taking this time to talk to us tonight.
Thank you for taking the time, and thank you for having me.
Thank you for coming back home, brother. You know, when you're talking about my hometown of Philly, I'm like, uh-oh. I can't even go home now, though.
Shout out all my homies in North Philly. Shout out all my homies in North Philly.
And it's so fun. Well, my high school was in North Philly. I wouldn't even know Philadelphia if I went back. Like, I know certain places, but I don't know the city anymore. I'm like, what's that? What side of town are we on? I don't even know anymore. But once again, everybody, check out the AtlantaFilmFestival.com site, Atlanta Film Society. Again, remember, we've got those two scholarships for Jan Mullen's class coming up, directing from the heart. It should be a wonderful class. I know Jan is a fabulous teacher and wonderful filmmaker. So sign up for that and, you know, get that scholarship. Go on and get that scholarship, okay? Once again, thank you to Justice. Thank you to Kevon. Thank you to Krupa, who are the ones that make all this work and make sure it's on YouTube. It's on Facebook. It's on Instagram. Make sure you're following us on Instagram. Follow, you know, Christian and I also on Instagram, if you like. You know, Karen Ceesay. Christian, what's your Instagram handle for the follow?
It is at YNG, N as in Nancy, GYHWH.
Okay, well, we're going to have to put that somewhere because I don't know if people got that.
Yeah, that's a lot. It's a lot. I try not to be found on Instagram, actually. But
oh, so I'm just outing you right now. But my bad.
No, it's cool. Follow me. Ask me any questions about the creation process or anything.
All right. Well, thank you so much. Tune in next week. Next week will be fun. We've got, I believe we've got Jeff Keating next week. Thank you so much for coming here. Support local filmmakers. The Atlanta Film Festival has been doing that forever. We've got our film festival coming up in September. We're in August. Oh my God, how are we already midway through August? Anyway, thank you so much. Signing off, I'm Karen Ceesay, KarenCeesay. Look at that, I had to throw that out. All right, guys, signing off. See you next week.